Okay, well, I think we might start as, since the trickle through the door has declined. So welcome to, this is the second to last for this quarter, I think, for the informatics department seminar. And very pleased to be able to introduce Jacki O'Neill today. So Jacki is a very well-known researcher in HCI and CSCW. She comes from that sort of like British tradition of ethnomethodologically informed ethnography. We have a shared institutional history in some way, having both spent time at Xerox, at Europark and the Xerox Research Center Europe in Grenoble. But nowadays, Jacki is at MSR in Bangalore, the Indian Microsoft Research Lab in India, where a number of our students over the years have spent time as interns, Nupur most recently working with Jacki there. And so this the work Jackie's going to talk about today comes from sort of part of the project that she's been working on, or actually a sort of intersection of two projects, it sounds like, that she's been working on there for the last couple of years, and you'd rather hear about it from her rather than me. So thank you.
So I'm going to talk about, is Uberization the future of work? And the two projects that Paul was talking about are, I was originally in Xerox before I moved to Microsoft studying crowdwork and crowdworkers in both the US and India. And then when I moved to Microsoft, I started studying drivers who were using Ola, which is India's homegrown Uber. Specifically, initially auto rickshaw drivers, and then with Nupur, we've been looking at Uber cab drivers and Ola cab drivers. And when I started doing the Ola auto, I didn't think it had anything to do with the crowdsourcing research that I'd been doing. I was like, oh, it's a real shame. I'm just starting to get real traction, like with the crowd work and the crowdsourcing research. People are really getting to know about this. This is going really well. And now I've moved companies, so I have to leave it all behind. And I'm going to do this other thing, which is really interesting. But it's a complete change of setting, of study. However, it turns out that it isn't. There are remarkable parallels between crowd work and crowdsourcing and Uber driving or Ola driving. And I'm going to pull out some of those parallels today under the sort of rough, slightly euphemistic, or maybe not euphemistic, is Uberization the future of work? If you know anything about me, you will know that I don't think it is. However, it has quite a lot of consequences. This type of work has quite a lot of consequences, I suspect, for much wider types of work. And I want to draw out some of those by comparing these two sites. However, I first of all want to give you a very brief introduction to the TEM, the Technologies for Emerging Markets group, or area, as we are called now. Because that's one thing about working in industry, they really do like to reorganize you on a very regular basis. And I also want to give you a very brief introduction to ethnography for design. I know a lot of you will be familiar with ethnography, but I still think for those of you who are not, it's worth going over what it is and why it matters. This has become particularly apparent to me because I work in a very, very, very technical lab. The research lab, the Microsoft Research Lab in India, is highly technical. We have a massive computational theory group. We have a big section on systems and cryptography and things like that. So I have become aware, you know, I got very nicely into my niche in Xerox where they think ethnography is great, and every single research lab across Xerox had an ethnography group, and I was coordinating them all when I left. And then I came to Microsoft where they just think we're nuts. Okay? So just in case you also think we're nuts, I'm just going to remind you why we're useful. and then I'll talk about the Uberization studies. So, okay. We are a group that primarily focused on ICT4D, so information and communication technologies for development. So specifically thinking about the design of technology for low-income communities, people living in urban slums, people living in rural areas, How can technology help those people? Technology is typically designed, particularly by companies like mine, for people with a lot of money and a lot of bandwidth and big screens and all that. However, there's an awful lot of opportunity, we would think, for technology to help people in low-income settings. But it is really, really, really important to understand what they need. And so this is our sort of pipeline. The understanding bit is absolutely crucial. I'm an ethnographer, of course, I would say that. So we really go out into the world and try and understand what are the problems that people have. We typically work, so one of the things we care about is having impact. And that impact can be academic, so through papers and so on, business group, although in TEM we tend to have less business group impact, or societal impact. So we often partner with someone, a real world organization, an NGO, a social enterprise, who has a problem. But even though they come to you with a problem that they think they need you to solve, that's not enough. If you just built a technology based on what they told you the problem was, it would never work. Usually because they don't actually know what the problem is. The problem for the people who are going to use the technology is often very different from the problem that the people who are going to deploy the technology think. And so we like to get out and do ethnographic studies, other methods of data collection to really understand what are the needs of the communities and how can we help them, and is technology even a solution? So often the solution isn't technology. I was talking at the University of Washington on Wednesday about a project I'm doing where one of the solutions really, there was nothing we could do in the technical space to intervene. We just help them understand, help the NGO understand that they probably shouldn't move to digital money in a whole scale way, and that was our solution. If we do find a problem that we think technology could help, then we design and build the solution that we think would help. It has to be very, very iterative, okay? Because as I talk about when I'm talking about ethnography to design, moving from study to design is a creative process. So you need to get back out there and build and test, build and test. The other thing we tend to really want to do is evaluate our technology in the real world. And this is because if we want to have some sort of impact, it's really important to see if your technology really works in the hands of users. So we don't tend to just build prototypes and then not test them. Unless, well, I'll show you the pipeline shortly. And then this is the thing, this is the real reason for working at Microsoft Research for me, and in industrial labs generally, is to have the opportunity of something that you do, something that you build, something that you make, actually ending up in the hands of real users. And as we don't have a product line really for the TEM work, because it's not Microsoft's core market, we tend to use those NGOs or government to try and actually put our technologies into use. So I'm not going to talk about, I could spend the whole hour talking about these example projects. The main point of this slide is to show that we have a continuum from things that are just making a research contribution, a contribution to academia, to conceptual arguments, and things that actually end up in the real world. The really important thing to realize about this is we don't know when we start out where they're going to be along that continuum. Sometimes we do. We knew Krishni Pustak was a farmer Facebook, basically. So it's Facebook for low literate users. It requires no text input. We knew that would never go anywhere other than a technology probe, because farmers in rural India don't have smartphones and they don't have data packs. So we know that that's not going to go anywhere right now. Maybe in 5 years or 10 years it might go somewhere. But right now it's stuck there. But sometime later you might see it over here. Ola Auto, which is one of the studies I'm going to talk about today, when I started doing it, I thought I might be able to have an impact because I partnered up with an organization who was working with a company called TFS, Taxis for Sure, and they at that time were doing TFS Auto. And they'd given it to my partner company to run. So that was one of the reasons I was so excited, because I was like, I can go out, see what's happening. If I have design ideas, I can implement them and I can try them out. However, whilst I'd only just started the study, Ola bought TFS, got rid of all the TFS people, and had its own Ola Auto, and there's not any opportunity to partner there. But maybe there would have been, and maybe there will be in the future. Whereas this bit of the project, which I was just doing to keep TW, my partner organization, happy, ended up being something that we're building a prototype for. And then these are both, this is TB treatment, which is designed by Bill Thies. It's a very low-tech solution. So this is the other thing I should say. It really, many of the technologies we build in the TEM group are actually really low-tech. In this case, it's a phone number on the back of a pill packet. You ring that number, and that shows you had your TB medication in your hand, and you no longer have to go to these stations that involve you traveling a whole day for them to observe you taking your TB medication. This is being rolled out across the whole of India. If it's successful there, they're doing random urine analysis to make sure that pills in the hands really do mean pills in the body. If it's successful, it could be the new TB standard for the whole world. And Bill Thies recently won the MacArthur Award for this project. So there's things, there are opportunities to make real impact. If I ever make as much impact as that, I would be ecstatic. Okay, ethnography for design. So, let me build this a little bit. Ethnographic studies, detailed, disciplined, empirical, as I have to emphasize again and again in my own workplace, studies of the organization of activity. My key method is observation. I'm primarily an observational ethnographer. Of course, I do interviews and so on. But observation is particularly important because, as Margaret Mead says, well, you can't see that it's Margaret Mead because I seem to have a weird taskbar that we couldn't get rid of. What people say, what people do, and what people say they do are entirely different things. So it's really important to go out and look at what people are doing as well as talk to them about it. And the aim is to understand the complexity of the situation on the ground from the perspective of the people who are on the ground. And as Paul said, I'm have an ethno-methodological leanings. I'm not really about building theory. I find this is particularly appropriate when you want to build technology because it requires that you look at all the tiny, tiny, tiny details of all the things that make the world look like they do. And that is really important when you're trying to design technology that's going to change that world in some way. Oops. However, when you're moving to design, it's not that we want to just recreate the world exactly as it is, just electronically. We often want to transform that world. So the study is just a resource for design. And in my experience, it's not enough to do a study and then just pass off the findings for someone else to build something. You have to be integrally involved in that building, the technology. And it, as I mentioned, it requires user-centered, iterative design. Truly useful technology supports and enhances natural human capacities. It's artfully integrated with human behavior. It's made at home in the world. And this is particularly important to remember now in these days when machine learning and conversational interfaces have been rebranded again as AI, because this is going to be really, really, really important. Some of the biggest AI challenges, and I am not underestimating the challenges of designing a conversational interface or improving our machine learning, are HCI challenges. How can you make that technology meaningful to the user? How can the user use that technology? That's an HCI problem, and that's a massive challenge. So, I'm going to talk now about the main body of my presentation, Uberization and the future of work. So we have all these changes going on in the world of work. There are platforms for digital work, platforms for physical work, apps that connect people to services and goods in new types of ways. The proliferation of these apps, combined with the popularity of Uber and the way that Uber has apparently transformed the taxi market, have led some people to say that Uberization is the future of work. This is what a search for Uberization brings up. Okay, healthcare tracking, anxiety, banking, who knows. As far as I could tell, it's a catch-all that's loosely used to mean the transformation of some sort of business or area through technology innovation, which is pretty broad. If we want to refine it a little bit, however, it encompasses the following trends. So typically the work is performed by a non-contracted workforce. I think they're called partners by Uber. I've also heard them be called micro-entrepreneurs. A bit euphemistic. If you ask one of my auto rickshaw drivers if they're a micro-entrepreneur, I don't think you'll get a yes. They're modeled by the platform as independently competing for work. So there's no communication or collaboration built into that system. And they work in a technologically mediated workplace or labor market. This is particularly important because the way that the labor market is modeled is the way that the work is perceived and done. So the fact that they're modeled as independently competing for work means that there's no communication and collaboration tools typically in these platforms. And then taskification is where the work is performed as a series of individual tasks. So that could be micro-tasking in crowdsourcing or one ride. One ride could be considered to be a task in Uber. You go from this point to this point. Although interestingly, I should say, in India, you can now hire your Uber or your Ola for a day or a half day because that's sort of how we do our taxis over there. So I'm going to look at what the reality is for workers on these platforms. So these are the two platforms I've really spent most time on. Amazon Mechanical Turk, which is a crowdsourcing platform. So it's digital work. It's global. And you have to have a certain amount of technical and English literacy to work on AMT. All the people with the work are based in the US. It's done on your computer or your phone. And then the second platform is mainly Ola with a little tiny bit of Uber as well, and primarily Ola Auto. This is local work, it's physical work, and the people using the platform have a range of print and technical literacies. For most of my auto rickshaw drivers, they had never used the internet or a smartphone before Ola gave them this phone. But the phone that Ola gave them is a locked phone. You can only use it for Ola. And the reason for this is because Ola pays for the data. So how the platforms are designed, even though, as I mentioned, even though these are really quite different types of work, they have an awful lot of similarities. And the way the platforms are designed have consequences for the workers, for the customers, or the employers. But there's always three parties involved in these interactions. There's the platform provider, there's the worker, and then the customer, who might be the person who wants a ride, or the work provider, the person who wants like images labeled or job done on AMT. So, first of all, I would like to say why we should care about any of this. Now, I'm sure you all care, but just in case you don't, I want to say why it matters. So with the increase in this type of work, with cloud computing, what's now called AI, conversational interfaces, machine learning, whatever, technology really is becoming more and more ubiquitous. It's becoming integrated into every part of our lives. And it has far-reaching consequences for the people who have to use that technology. As computer scientists at the cutting edge of technology design, we have a role in defining the future of work. The things that we build are actually going to have consequences to people in the real world. And it might be you're just coming up with technology ideas that end up in someone else's product way outside. But still, you need to think about the people who are going to be using the technologies, the people you're going to design for. We can embrace the fact that the technologies that we build are going to have far-reaching consequences for people, and try and design with the users in mind. So a lot of the problem with crowdsourcing systems, I would say, is because they were designed with a very technical model. Let's call people like they're an API call, and let's just forget about 100 or 200 or 300 years of management science and how to handle people and how to manage workers. Let's just treat them like an API. And this is really important that we don't do this. And I would say that it also has consequences for the quality of the work you get. This isn't just a moral argument. If we ignore it, we have problems. Because workplace technologies which don't take into account people's work practices end up being disrupted. So rather than using it properly as you should, you end up working around it, or you end up not using it at all. They also cause frustration to customers and to workers. And if anyone has ever called a call center for any reason, you will know what I'm talking about. I spent an awful lot of time in call centers, studying call centers. The reason they are so appalling is because the technology that the workers in the call center is using stops them being able to answer your call, because it takes away all agency from those workers. And they certainly don't enable us to produce the best possible work. So, my argument is we should design to enhance human capabilities rather than trying to ignore them. So for this presentation, I'm going to use four lots of data, or data from four studies. So there's a study of Indian crowd workers. This was done by Neha Gupta, who was a PhD student working with me. Observations, recordings, people recorded their desktop while they're working on AMT and sent them to her, interviews and so on. Auto rickshaw drivers in Bangalore. We basically followed drivers around. So you can't sit in the auto rickshaw with the driver, because if you're sitting in it, no one's going to flag it down. So we basically hired an auto rickshaw to follow the auto rickshaw in front that we were following, and we sat in that one. And it was either drivers who had Ola or didn't have Ola. If they had Ola and they got an Ola ride while we were following behind, they would tell us. We would jump into their cab, their auto rickshaw. We would sit in with them while they went to pick up the Ola passenger, so we could see how many conversations they had, whether they followed the GPS, all of those things. Ola and Uber cab drivers. This is Nupa's research. She's hiding somewhere there. Observations of ride sharing, interviews with drivers and passengers. And this is a little bit of an outlier, but we'll come to why. I also, when I first started looking at crowdsourcing, I didn't set out and look at crowdsourcing. It was in 2011. And there wasn't an awful lot of crowdsourcing going on. There was a little bit. But I was interested in whether we could crowdsource BPO work. So I did a study of BPO work to understand what BPO work was like, picked the lowest skill BPO work I could find, which was form digitization. And I'll talk about that in a bit. Okay. So the first topic I want to address is, what's it like to work in these new digital labor markets as a non-contracted worker, or to be a micro-entrepreneur? Okay, first of all, it isn't all bad. Workers absolutely value their independence and flexibility. That's a prime reason for working in these labor markets. However, if we take a closer look at what independence and flexibility actually looks like. For flexibility, we can look at AMT. And I should say I have could give you examples for both, from both types of both of the technologies, but for reasons of time I won't. You might think of crowd work as being the ultimate flexible working. I think Howe, in his original definition of crowd work, said it was a way to use spare moments and make them productive. So you could earn money in their spare moments of time. So leaving aside philosophically whether we think we have spare moments of time that we want to use productively, which is a whole different argument. Our crowd workers sort of agreed with this a little bit. I also try to look for work on MTurk when I have some time. And most of the people said this, you know, the people who answered that very tiny survey, which was actually just a door opener so we could get observations and interviews, said, yes, I do it whenever I have the time. However, when we looked a bit closer, we found that this is common. But mostly I work at night because that's when there's some jobs available. Okay? And we found this again and again. And with the US crowd workers as well as the Indian crowd workers, it actually ends up being the crowd worker who has to be flexible to the work on the platform rather than that they can work whenever they want to. For independence, let's look at Ola Auto. Auto drivers were already independent workers before they started using Ola Auto. Ola acts as a digital middleman, and it actually erodes the independence of the drivers. It controls the platform, the algorithms, the network, and intervenes between drivers and the customers. That might be okay if it helped them earn more money. Unfortunately, it does little to reduce the uncertainty of their day. As Mr. L says, if you wait for Ola rides to come in when you're waiting at a particular location, you end up waiting all day without getting either normal or Ola passengers. And I should say that, so auto rickshaw drivers are a financially vulnerable community. Their biggest concern is the uncertainty and the unpredictableness of their day. Are they going to get enough rides? And I should also say, so we found this, and a couple of months after we finished our study, the auto drivers came to their similar conclusion and left Ola en masse because they were concerned that it was eroding their independence and taking away their freedom, and it wasn't working in their best interests, whilst at the same time it wasn't really helping them earn any more money. And now, the interesting thing about that is that Ola, to get them back on board, is now trying to design things that are actually useful to the auto drivers, which is nice and telling when Uber, what Uber will say about the drivers are fine, the drivers like us, and there was the panel that I was on at CSTW where the Uber lady exactly said this, the drivers can vote with their feet. If they didn't like us, they wouldn't work for us. And you're like, I don't think they can vote with their feet, unless they have another easily available job. The auto rickshaw drivers can vote with their feet because they can pick up passengers off the street, and more of their passengers don't use Ola than do use Ola. So you see that once they can vote with their feet, they do, and that puts some interesting power relationships in there. So current platform designs, current platform designs limit both the independence and flexibility of workers in these labour markets. So I want to talk, how we take the time, about motivation and job satisfaction. So this is where I'll bring in the BPO work. So first of all, motivation and job satisfaction, this isn't just fuzzy stuff, okay? This isn't just nice to have. This is absolutely key to getting the work done. And just because workers are self-employed doesn't mean that motivation and job satisfaction doesn't matter anymore. But it's often forgotten in functional accounts of the work and when we're designing technology to support the work. And crowdsourcing, I have to say, is the biggest example of this. This becomes really obvious when you compare crowdsourcing to outsourcing. Okay. Now remember, I studied the lowest skill outsourcing that I could find, form digitization, a job you might think would be great for crowdsourcing. It was paid piece rate. It was either paid per character or per form you filled in. Again, something you might think would be ideal for crowdsourcing. However, what we found is that not only were there problems in AMT not managing the workflow so that you couldn't crowdsource this work, we also found as important, if not more important, problems around motivation and job satisfaction. Specifically, the outsourcer's workflow is sensitively orchestrated to encourage the workers to do the best work, okay? The workers are made accountable for the work that they do and the quality of the work they do. Targets are made achievable. So the BPO person might say, every worker should complete 50 forms. And you've got workers on the floor who have completed 12 forms during their shift or 14 forms during their shift. If you tell them they should complete 50 forms, they're just going to go, So instead of doing that, what the supervisors do is they say, you only completed 12 forms, you really need to get that up to 20. Okay? So they just like ignore the official targets and they make the targets achievable so that these workers have a reason to try and improve their work. Fairness is demonstrated. When they make any changes whatsoever to the system and the way that they're paid, they spend an awful lot of time and effort communicating that to the workers so that they don't feel alienated and as though they're doing more work for less money. And then training and feedback are given. So these are a whole set of like social practices to get good work. Crowdsourcing, however, designs out the relationship between the worker and the employer and the organization, and it replaces complex social, organizational, and financial motivators solely with monetary ones, typically at lower pay. So it is no wonder that the results that you get from crowdsourcing are often not very good, and certainly wouldn't work in a BPO workflow where you have to have 99% quality and 100% of the work done and done quickly. So, many of the problems I've pointed out come from the way these particular platforms are designed. Okay? We can certainly think of designing better platforms. Okay, we can think of ways to support and enhance worker agency, to take into account workers' practices. One thing, for example, is around relationship-based crowdsourcing, where you actually let requesters, the people with the work, form loose relationships with the people doing the work so they can put some of those social motivational factors back in. And actually in crowdsourcing we do find that people will form, they will work around Amazon Mechanical Turk to have a relationship with sets of workers. But we can also think of platform agnostic design to support digital workers as a whole. So what types of things might we have? So these are meant to be freelancers. Many of them work on multiple platforms, but they don't have much good information to make the choices about where they should work next, because the work in the marketplace is largely opaque unless you're in them, and even if you're in them, it can be rather opaque. If you're an Ola or Uber driver, you only see the job that's popping up now. Boom, it pops up. In AMT, you can see the range of jobs, so you have a better... So we could think of ways to enable workers to visualize the work that's in marketplaces now and make more informed choices about where they're going to work next. And we can also think about how we can support career development through a dynamic, portable, platform-agnostic CV. At the moment, your reputation in one platform stays there. And I think I talk more about reputation in a bit. So. That was that part. The second part is independently competing for work. So, leaves workers asking, who do we talk to, who do we learn from? So they're modeled as being completely independent agents in competition with one another. I guess it takes the sort of economic modeling of how people work. So platforms basically design collaboration out of the work. But the work in practice actually remains collaborative. In crowdwork, we see networks of crowdworkers, both physical and virtual. So this is a picture of some people in Hyderabad who are AMT workers. They meet every month to have snacks, share experiences, chat. So community and support is an important reason for this. There's also, they help one another manage the scarcity of good jobs. So having good jobs on the platform is a problem, so you don't want to miss them while you're sleeping. So people will set up networks. So if someone sees this job comes online, they ring you up and wake you up, and you start doing the work. And also for work quality. So Mary Gray and Sid Suri and their students actually found that people collaborate online about individual jobs. So if they're doing a translation job, they might ask, what was this word? Did you hear this word? And then they'll work together to make sure they've got the right word. This is worrying for the people who are requesters, but actually it helps you get better work. And if you sit in any BPO office, you will see people doing exactly that. They help each other work things out. And as I mentioned, the employers, the people who provide the work, end up working around the system to form these loose relationships with the workers, because they find it's better to have workers, like a group of workers that you semi-know. And they end up just using the platform to put the jobs out there and to pay the workers. It's similar with Uber and Ola, and we know from studies of the US, there was a great study by Lee, that drivers use forums to organize, to make sense of the app, to try and understand what the algorithms are doing. But Ola Auto drivers don't have this option because they don't have internet access, they don't have smartphones. So they get together at lunchtime in the same place if they don't have a job, where they think that they're more likely to get Ola rides, and they'll have a chat. There, for example, there's Ola hotspots, and they know about the Ola hotspots because they ride through an area and their Ola phone beeps a lot, okay? So then they communicate that amongst themselves. The problem is, it's much less powerful because you have less voices. It only works if you're connected to a good social network who can help you. So there was one driver who hadn't been able to log on to his Ola system for 2 weeks, and it was a really simple problem, and we were able to help him with that, but he hadn't wanted to ask anyone. He felt embarrassed, and he didn't really want to ask for help. And also, there's less voices, so it's less powerful because you have less voices. The reasons that the Uber drivers in the US are able to work things out is there's loads of them. So by putting their collective experience together, they can really try and work out what's going on in the app with the app. So I mentioned putting the relationships back and relationship-based crowdsourcing. We can also think of how can we enable and support local and global networks of drivers, crowd workers, and so on. What type of communication mechanisms, now you don't have organizational boundaries keeping these people together, what types of communication mechanisms would work? How would workers find one another? What are the implications for trust? Often you trust people because they're within your organization. How do you get around some of these things? And one thing that's also really interesting is, can we think of ways to enable loose collaborations of people to come together for particular tasks or particular types of work? I've got random numbers on my slides. Please ignore the numbers. I'm a qualitative researcher. Numbers make no sense. So algorithmic management, I realize I've been going on a bit. Speed up a bit. Basically, these systems have to use algorithmic management. They have lots of individual small jobs, and they have lots of workers, and they have to somehow match them together. They can't do that if they don't do it largely automatically. But what's it like when your manager is an algorithm? Okay, around taskification and coordination work. So coordination work, I'm sure you all know, is the work to organize people and groups so they work harmoniously together. It's often hidden work, and again, it's often not included in the design of systems, but it's long been known in CSCW that if you don't support this type of work when you're building collaborative systems, it's going to be a problem. It's likely to become much more difficult and time-consuming once you break things down into lots of small tasks, lots of small parts. Unfortunately, digital systems rarely support easy coordination work. They either leave it to the user, and we see this in Amazon Mechanical Turk, where you have to find your own work. And one of the problems for the Turkers is they spend many hidden hours looking for jobs to do. Okay, they're not paid for that work. Or they automate it. And a lot of the power of this system comes around from the systems comes from the idea you can automate this work. However, automation is not as simple. And I'm going to give you a really, really simple example, which is task assignment, ride assignment in driving, which should be fairly simple. It's just one ride and one rider. How do you match them together? However, to show you why it doesn't take into account all the contingencies, I'm going to compare ride assignment for cabs and ride assignment for autos. So, these rides have different contingencies. The journey time is one. You typically book cabs for a longer journey time, and for the passenger, you've waited 15 minutes. You phone the guy up. He's going to be another 15 minutes. What are you going to do? You're probably going to wait for him, because to order another cab, you've got to go into either another app or the same app, order another cab. You're going to wait at least 15 minutes for them. I don't know if anyone's noticed the minimum time for an Uber to arrive is 15 minutes, mostly, unless you're in a particular area of New York, maybe. I don't know. In India, it certainly is, and it's often much longer. For auto rickshaws, they're booked for much shorter journey times. It's just often you're going to go much shorter. And the opportunity for passengers, if the guy's not coming, you just hop into a passing auto. You don't need to wait, you don't need to book a cab, you just jump into another auto. Furthermore, auto rickshaw drivers aren't dependent on the app, so if they get bad ride assignments, they will cancel them. Whereas the cab driver will not cancel a bad ride assignment, because that's going to be bad for his ratings, and he really cares about the app. It's also bad for the auto driver's ratings, but he doesn't need the app so much, he's not as dependent on it. Now, I'm sure there's lots of clever people in this room who design algorithms. Of course you could design an algorithm that takes into account these contingencies. I'm surprised they haven't done it. However, the whole point is it's almost impossible to algorithmically specify all the contingencies, even in simple cases like this. And if it's going to be hard in simple cases like this, imagine, and this is a slight deviation into the AI thinking, imagine what it's going to be like if you want to do it for complex knowledge work, where the contingencies are much, much more difficult. And then second example is worker evaluation. So workers are considered interchangeable apart from their ratings and their reputation. And I'll give you the example of Ola. So you'll be familiar with this because it's similar to Uber. So you as a passenger rate the driver. And Uber themselves also rates the driver that feeds into this star, just like Ola do, on things like cancellations, ride acceptances, all of these things feed into the rating. However, the implementation is poor. And this is particularly the case for the auto drivers. I'm not going to speak for US Uber drivers. And it's poor because the drivers don't understand it. So, as this guy says, sometimes in the afternoon I have lesser stars and it increases in the evening. Some days when I've got lots of rides, I get lesser stars. Some days when I barely have any passengers, I get rated high. I'm not entirely sure why this happens. And another guy was saying, and sometimes I get a low rating and then I switch off my phone and I put it away because I'm really angry. And he's got no idea what's happening. Okay, so if drivers don't know what's happening, how can they change it? How can they try and be the best driver possible, which presumably is what the system's for, if they don't understand it? It's also poor in a second way. It's poor in a second way because it isn't fair. Many of the things that drivers get rated badly on are not their fault or not in their control. So I might give a driver one star. Now, I wouldn't do this because I know. But if I didn't know, I might give a driver one star for turning up after half an hour when the app told me he would be there in 5 minutes. Okay? However, we know for a fact, because Ola has told us this, that they deliberately underestimate the time that it will take the driver to get to you, because otherwise you'd go and use Uber instead. And they're in direct competition. Okay? So this is one thing. Which is fine if they want to do that, but don't penalize the drivers for it. And then the second thing is some things that are outside of Ola's control, but also not in the driver's control. This might be more particular to India, I'm not sure, which is the GPS doesn't know which side of the road you're on. Okay? Traffic in Bangalore is an absolute nightmare. Many of these big roads have a big partition in the middle. You have to drive a mile up that way, do a U-turn, drive down there to pick up the passenger who might not be very far away from you. That can easily take half an hour, okay? So that feeds into the ratings as well. And also drivers, as I mentioned, if they cancel rides get a bad rating, but they might be cancelling for the good of everybody, the good of the passenger. An auto driver will typically, you phone them up, because they're low income, you phone them up rather than them phoning you up. And I guess here you don't phone people. So in India, you don't really get an Uber or an Ola, whether it's a car or an auto, without having some sort of conversation with the driver. We saw three or four as a regular thing. So you phone them up and they tell you, they say, where are you? And you say where you are, and they go, okay, I'm not coming. And they'll try and get you to cancel, the ones who know, or they will cancel because they just know that it's not worth either of you to wait half an hour for a guide to come. And they're so fed up because when they get there and the passenger's gone, they've just wasted all their time. So it's not actionable by the drivers. And if it's not actionable by the drivers, then who's it for? Well, presumably it's for Ola to decide which are the good or bad drivers. But I would argue that Ola can't even decide which are the good or bad drivers because it's not within the control of the drivers. Okay. Let me see. So for AMT, sorry, I'm almost there. Okay. So for AMT, they also are concerned with maintaining a good reputation. I should put that up. Reputation is number of hits, that's tasks completed, some sort of reviewer, some sort of request or qualification, approval rate. It's important to do this because it determines which tasks you can work on or not. However, they have very little information about why they get blocked or why they get suspended or why their work gets rejected. And so they tend to manage their reputation in the dark. And this means, in their case, they end up doing a lot of hidden work to manage their reputation. So for example, they will specialize on things that they know is one thing, like because they know they can do it and they'll know they get a good rating. Or they will try before you buy. This was really common. People would do surveys before accepting the hit to make sure could do the survey before they accepted the hit. The problem with that is sometimes the hit's gone by the time you've done the survey. And that's unpaid work. They are on the side of caution because the consequences are so dire of making mistakes. And it's very difficult for them to understand what's going on AMT, so they just are very, very cautious. And it's really not clear for them as well how much reputation is in their hands. So, again, we can design better algorithms, for sure. And we should try and design better algorithms, okay? But they're always unlikely to be able to take into account all the situated complexities of the world. So we need to think about how we design for failure. These things are always going to fail. How do we enable the people who are using them to make sense of that failure? At the moment, it is always the user who ends up in trouble. That might be the driver who gets a poor rating. That might be I'm from Microsoft, so I'm going to say the Word document user who is really frustrated because every time they try and format their document, their picture moves. And they have no idea why, and they have to turn the whole thing into rich text format or text format and then reformat it again. And it's a nightmare. It causes immense amount of frustration. And for AI, the consequences are potentially much more catastrophic as well, of failure. We also need to think about how we can design for fair algorithmic management. And this is really important because what happens? In these cases, the workers are very frustrated because they feel that the company is against them. So if you feel the company is against you, not with you, you're going to start trying to game that company. You start gaming that company has to spend an awful lot of money, time, and resources on trying to control its workers. And of course, the ironic thing is the more they try and control their workers, the more the workers are unhappy and try and game the system. And you just end up in this vicious cycle of wasting money when you could actually be designing things that make people work better and do better work. And for my last slide. And then this is just a question, which is, what would technology look like if we started designing for worker agency and individuality and like celebrated all the things that are the reasons why we have people in systems anyway, it would look very different to what we have now. But if anyone could do it, that'd be great. Okay, so to conclude, as technology becomes ever more pervasive, designs which support and enhance human practice are increasingly important. And I've done a critical analysis of some of the trends of Uberization and platform-based work. And then there's some design challenges. How can we enhance independence and flexibility? How can we build in motivation and job satisfaction? I should say one thing for that is just stop treating people like they're bits of a computer and start remembering that they're people. Design for fair algorithmic management. I know that that is a really hard challenge, but it's one we're going to have to solve if we want to move advance with AI. And designing for worker agency and individuality. And then I'm going to say this because I can't emphasize it enough. Ethnography is really important. It can help us design better futures of work by understanding what's going on now and seeing the opportunities for innovation and change. And it doesn't just get at the surface problems, it can get at the really fundamental problems with some of the systems we have. And finally, why should we care? It really is in our hands to design better futures for everybody. So we should try and do it. Thank you. Oh, and I just wanted to put this last one up, which is, if anyone is working in this space and wants to contribute to a discussion on minimum wage for online labor platforms, Six Silverman has one going here. I said I would advertise it, so please take note.
Okay, we do have some time for questions.
So I've done all the talking, everyone's run out.
I have one. Mm-hmm. It does seem that through across a whole bunch of these, the interesting thing is that what's been lost is a sort of intermediating role played by managers, played by firms or collectives. Mm-hmm. I mean, some of this is actually about trying to recreate exactly that intermediary, which might be a human intermediary or an organizational intermediary that's been sort of eliminated by the platform. I was just sort of struck by that commonality across so many of these cases.
I agree. And that's one of the big things with algorithmic management as well. We don't need a person to manage you anymore. Stick in some algorithms, it'll be fine. So I really agree. And I think there's a lot of opportunity in this space. So some parts, the very extreme versions of Uberization and crowdsourcing, I think are quite limited to certain types of work. However, there is gonna be a range. We see a range of work, increasing amount of freelancers and platforms and things that are going on that are less extreme, which include professional work. And so I think that when we start thinking about that type of work again, it's already important here. It becomes even more important there. And you want to think about, what I really don't want is for people to take this model and try and apply it elsewhere more widely. We should actually go from a different perspective, which is thinking of what we have with the technologies we have now and what we know about how we manage people and how people work, and design different collaborative tools for them to come together, perhaps in looser organizations, but not this extreme.
So when I think of someone getting into some industry, probably want to move through some set of, some career path or something like that, where they're doing some different jobs throughout their life. People that work on these platforms, do they imagine themselves driving for Uber for the rest of their life, or they imagine maybe they move between platforms doing similar types of work? What is my overall life experience in using this life?
Yeah, that's a very good question. It's almost too early to say. I think the range of people who drive for Uber, it's very different in India to the US. The range of people who drive for Uber in the US is a whole set of people. I've done informal chats with Uber drivers, basically. And it's, people who have got made redundant and then actually found they can make as much money on this, so they think, yeah, why not? I might as well do that. People paying their way through college or whatever. And in the US anyway, I think there's always been a sort of So I used to go to Florida, maybe for the group conference, and the taxi from the airport, the guy, you'd be like, oh, you're from Florida? And he's like, oh, no, I'm retired. I'm thinking, you're driving my taxi. That's not my definition of retired. So there's a whole set of different things. In India, people are really doing it as their job, and actually it is preferable, typically, to what they were doing before, because they were driving for a hotel, or a cab, and they would get a wage of about 20,000 rupees a month, which is maybe just under $300 a month. Is that right? Yes. Yes, just under $300 a month. Now they're earning triple that. Okay, they work the same hours, they're earning triple that, and so that's currently, we'll see how it changes. We've still got Uber and Olo in direct battling it out for market segment. And they have some flexibility. The flexibility is incredibly limited because they're still working 14 to 16 hour days. So how much flexibility do you have in a 14 to 16 hour day? But at least, you know, previously when you work for a hotel, the hotel tells you you're going to work this Sunday. You're going to do that airport pickup. No, you can't take your kids to school. And many of my auto drivers, so there's a range of things. The crowd workers, again, there's some people who are doing it after school, after college, before they get a job. There's some people who've left full-time employment to do crowd work. Many of the crowd workers, however, are people who need to work from home and need a bit more flexibility about hours. So again, they're often the nighttime working suits them. Even though it's not ideal. But one of the things, so with driving, I don't know what the career opportunities are. With the digital work in crowd work, I think it's really interesting to think about, can we help people upskill? Can we help people move on to more, that's why specialization is a problem. Can we help people to move on to more skilled work and either move into more formal jobs or get better opportunities in these informal economies if that's what they want to work. But at the moment, there isn't really any support for this, but it's certainly something we should think about.
Thanks for the wonderful presentation. I guess my question is pretty simple. I know Uber's been challenged by like taxi unions in cities like Philadelphia. Is there a similar union environment where you did the study? Or are the unions not really part of the conversation?
So unions is an interesting question. I don't think that there are any unions for the cab drivers. The auto drivers have a very strong, it's not quite a union, but it might as well be. They have a very strong representation. They actually have quite a strong political voice. And that's one of the reasons they've been able to vote with their feet with Ola. What's really interesting right now, though, in India, in Bangalore, is that all of the Ola and Uber drivers, cab drivers, not all of them, but vast majority of them were on strike for like at least 2 weeks before I came. This has completely disrupted the transportation system because everyone is very dependent on it now. So this is actually quite intriguing. I wish I had some researchers who could go and interview these people. And the reason they are on strike is because of unfair algorithmic management. So they are fed up that they're getting poor evaluations for something outside of their control, and then they get knocked out of the system for 2 hours. And it might be the rush hour, it might be the busiest, because that's, of course, the time you are gonna be late because the traffic's worse and the Ola's underestimating. So they're like directly on strike like that. I don't know how they've organized. I would love to find out. Because it's really, if we could do something over here like that, where you really just, because I know the Uber drivers do want to do that sometimes and fight for their rights. And the crowd workers, like Six Silverman and people like that, are doing a lot to help them self-organize. They don't want a union, but they want to be able to self-organize. So I think there's lots of opportunities.
Okay, one more.
Do you know of any research or any discussions within the profession about the need for affiliation for crowd workers? Is there generally a less affinity for social interaction among crowd workers? Is this like a special self-selected group that really doesn't need social affiliation? Or has the crowd work force, it addresses more complex work? Is there a higher need for social interaction?
So they do their own. So in the US, there's two big Amazon Mechanical Turk forums. And my colleague Dave Martin did a study of which one? One of them. And that was like, that's where workers actually have their social, you have to be, it's private, you can't just, no one can just, you can't just enter. And they work on that. They talk to one another about good jobs and good requesters and good places to work and hacks to make your system quicker and things like that. And then, but then they don't allow any Indians on that forum. And so the Indians actually self-organize through Facebook groups, which again are also private, where they'll have like little collectives of. So I think there's absolutely a need for social affiliation. It just has to go through sort of informal channels. And as I mentioned with the Hyderabad group, you know, they met regularly. And we met, you know, there's one place which was in one of the smaller towns in India, where there was actually 8 crowd workers working out of one office, but independently for themselves. They just all told each other about it and got into it that way. Because there are many, many, many money-making scams in India. Oh, phone this number to earn this amount of money. And so people tend to only start trusting systems when other people they know use them. So there are, I think affiliation is really important, and it will stay important as you move up.
So there is the opportunity to ask more questions, but it's not going to happen here. It will happen downstairs on the 5th floor at our weekly reception. So I'll ask you to join us down there, and also thank Jacki once more.